Deborah and I once again welcome you to worship in our home today, as do the other worship leaders who are participating with us on this third Sunday of Easter. Alleluia, Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia.
I have a couple of announcements to either say to you or remind you of as we begin worship. One is to remind you that this is indeed a worship of Holy Communion. So if you have not already done so, please prepare for yourself, if you'd like, a wafer or piece of bread for the first element of the Eucharist, as well as some wine or grape juice or even water for the second element, and have those ready for when we celebrate the sacrament later on in worship. Also, please remember those who are listed in the bulletin in your prayers this week. I would remind you that Phil Lewis is scheduled to have surgery this coming Tuesday on his back. Phil, later on in this worship, Phil is offering a very soulful harmonica rendition of Mourning Has Broken. We thank Phil for doing that. But Phil, certainly our prayers will be with you this coming week, and we hope your surgery goes well and certainly brings you the relief for which you are looking. And our prayers are also with Pam Farrell and her family. Pam lost her father, James Crockett, this past week. And Pam, certainly our thoughts and prayers are with you, and our hope and our faith is in the resurrection to eternal life in which your father now participates. We did have one birthday in our congregation this past week. Dorothy Masteller, her birthday was last Wednesday, and Dorothy, you're certainly in our prayers as you continue your chemotherapy. But let us wish you a happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Dorothy. Happy birthday to you.
Happy birthday.
Congratulations, Dorothy. Let us now prepare ourselves for worship.
Let us declare our faith in the God who created, redeems, and sanctifies us. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Now the feast and celebration, all the creation sings for joy. To the God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore. Feast of the Lamb once slain, whose blood has freed and united us to be one great people of God. Now the feast and celebration, all of creation sings for joy. To the God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore. Power and riches, wisdom and might, all honor and glory to Christ forever. Now the feast and celebration, all of creation sings for joy. To the God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore. For God has come to dwell with us, to make us people of God, to make all things new. Feast and celebration, all of creation sings for joy. To the God of life and love and freedom, praise and glory forevermore.
Let us pray together the prayer of the day. O God, your Son makes himself known to all his disciples in the breaking of bread. Open the eyes of our faith that we may see him in his redeeming work, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you. The first reading for the third Sunday of Easter is from the book of Acts, the second chapter. Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed the crowd. Therefore, let the entire house of Israel know with certainty that God has made him both Lord and Messiah, this Jesus whom you crucified. Now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and to the other apostles, "Brothers, what should we do?" Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ, so that your sins may be forgiven and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, for your children, and for all who are far away, everyone whom the Lord our God calls to him." And he testified with many other arguments and exhorted them, saying, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Psalm 116, verses 1 through 4 and 12 through 19. Let us read Psalm 116 together. I love the Lord who has heard my voice and listened to my supplication. For the Lord has given ear to me whenever I called. The cords of death entangled me, the anguish of the grave came upon me. I came to grief and sorrow. Then I called upon the name of the Lord. O Lord, I pray you, save my life. How shall I repay the Lord for all the good things God has done for me? I will lift the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all God's people. Precious is your sight, O Lord, and is the death of your servants. O Lord, truly I am your servant. I am your servant, the child of your handmaid. You have freed me from my bonds. I will offer you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call upon the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all God's people, in the courts of the Lord's house, in the midst of you, O Jerusalem. Hallelujah.
The second reading is from the book of 1 Peter, the first chapter. If you invoke as Father the one who judges all people impartially according to their deeds, live in reverent fear during the time of your exile. You know that you were ransomed from the futile ways inherited from your ancestors, not with perishable things like silver or gold, but with the precious blood of Christ, like that of a lamb without defect or blemish. He was destined before the foundation of the world, but was revealed at the end of the ages for your sake. Through him, you have come to trust in God, who raised him from the dead and gave him glory, so that your faith and hope are set on God. Now that you have purified your souls by your obedience to the truth, so that you have genuine mutual love, love one another deeply from the heart. You have been born anew, not of perishable, but of imperishable seed, through the living and enduring Word of God. Word of God, Word of life. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 24th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, on the same day when Jesus had appeared to Mary Magdalene, two disciples were going to a village called Emmaus, several miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you're walking along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, the things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word, before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things took place. Moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said. But they did not see him. Then he said to them, "Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?" Then, beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead, as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, "Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?" That same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, "The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon." Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he was made known to them in the breaking of the bread. The Gospel of our Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Hey everyone, it's so good to be with you this morning. I'm glad that you're here. I hope you're all doing okay. Hey, do you recognize me today? I look kind of different, don't I? Or maybe you don't know who I am. Take a look and see if I'm going to give you a minute to see if you can recognize who I am. Maybe it would help if I took my hat off. Does that help? Maybe it would help if I took the sunglasses off. And now I'm going to take off the mask and surely you'll know who I am. So, today's lesson is all about being able to recognize people. In our story for today, there were two of Jesus' friends who were walking down the road to Emmaus, and they were talking. And all of a sudden, another guy comes along and starts talking with them. And they just let him join in, but they were confused about who he was, but he just listened in. And then they decided to go home and have a meal, and they invited him to come. They still didn't recognize him, even though it was Jesus. They brought him into their home and they had communion together. And that's when they realized that this was Jesus. He did his breaking of the bread and giving the wine. And they knew that it was Jesus because they saw Jesus die on the cross, but they did not know that he was alive until that moment. And they did not expect him to be there. So when they did recognize him, they were so pleased to see Jesus. His prophecy had come true that he had been killed on the cross and then rose from the dead 3 days later. So today, I want to ask you, have you recognized Jesus in your life? When do you see him or when do you feel him there? Think about times when you have a decision to make and something in your head is telling you to do the right thing. And then you think, maybe I want to do the other thing. But then you end up doing the right thing, talking to your parents with respect and doing what they ask. That could be Jesus talking to you and saying, please do the right thing. You know what I've taught you. Jesus is with us always. We just have to recognize that he's there. That's my prayer for you this week. So let's pray together. Dear Heavenly Father, help us to recognize your presence in our lives. If we are lonesome, we can always talk to you because you are always there. Amen. So before we go, let's pretend we're on the altar again, and we're going to go down to the baptismal font and picture the font there with the water in it. Let's dip our fingers in the font and put the water to our head and say, I remember Jesus loves me. Have a good week.
Grace and peace to you this day, in the name of our risen Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Phil Gully is a favorite author of mine. Phil is a Quaker pastor who lives in Indiana. Phil tells great stories. One of them that is one in which he talks about one of his favorite childhood experiences. Of all the things I miss from my youth, Phil writes, heading the list would be soda pop. Soda pop was at its best when it came in glass bottles, plucked from the ice water chest at Logan's Mobile Station. Plus, if you gave Logan's your soda business, Wally and Bill would patch your bike tires for free. Wally and Bill were the owners of Logan's, having bought the business from Pop Logan. They never changed the name, knowing folks would call it Logan's no matter what they named it. People in my hometown, Phil says, don't take to change. My parents have lived in their house for more than 27 years, but it's still called the old Hollowell place after the people who lived there 50 years before. So Wally and Bill retained the name and the soda pop cooler, which was at the front by the cash register and the juicy fruit rack. Soda cost a dime. If you were in a hurry and wanted to take the bottle with you, it cost 12 cents. They would waive the extra 2 cents if you promised to bring the bottle back, but we were seldom in a hurry, so we would drink the whole soda while sitting on the cooler, the closest thing we had to air conditioning. If humanity, Phil says, has devised a more pleasant way to pass a hot August afternoon, that way has escaped me. Pedaling your Schwinn Typhoon to Logan's after a game of baseball, your throat scratchy with thirst, opening the cooler and surveying the rainbow of flavors, knee-high grape, Chocola, Mason's Root Beer, Double Cola, Royal Crown, Orange Crush, and Big Chief. Plunging your arm deep into the icy water and pulling out heaven. Sliding your dime across the glass top counter. Wally asking, drinking it here or taking it with you? Here, you'd answer, arranging yourself on the cooler, then drinking deep. If you were quiet enough, Oscar, the gas station cat, might settle on your lap. Nirvana. The quality of any given place increases exponentially if there's a good cat in the picture. You should be so lucky to have a cat take a liking to you. Oscar made a good place even better. A couple of years back, Phil says, I heard of a gas station that still sells soda pop in bottles from an ice water cooler. It was in a little town an hour and a half from my home, which seems a paltry distance to drive for such a treasure. On my next day off, I went. Prices had changed from 10 cents to 50. 60 cents if you're in a hurry and take the bottle with you. I stayed. Sat on the cooler, Coke in hand, peanuts in the other hand. But the joy wasn't there. Joy, after all, isn't something one orders up. It sneaks in on cat's feet and snuggles in your lap though you didn't call its name. You look down, and there it is, come to pay you a visit. There is a story in the Bible about two disciples trudging down the road to Emmaus after Jesus was killed. They were joined by a stranger who walked with them until supper time. "Eat with us," they invited. "We have plenty." So he lingered, gave thanks for the bread, and passed it around. Those disciples had no more taken a bite when they recognized that stranger as Jesus. After a collective wow, they hustled back to Jerusalem to share the resurrection news. Phil Gully concludes, "Joy visits when we least expect it. We're 10 years old and drinking deep from heaven's bottle, where life has bottomed out and Jesus drops in. Cat feet quiet. It isn't that God withholds it. Joy is always looking to climb into our laps. It's just that joy needs silence, and thus seldom settles into the lap of a noisy person. It's only when we stop talking long enough to whisper grace that joy has a way of rubbing against us, curling in our lap, making its presence known." Why is it, you suppose, that these two disciples don't recognize Jesus on the road to Emmaus? It certainly seems like they should have. It appears they knew Jesus quite well. They certainly knew a lot about him. Had Jesus changed so radically since the resurrection? Was this a new spiritual body that was totally different from the old physical one? Luke doesn't ascribe the difficulty to Jesus' appearance. He locates the problem within the disciples themselves. "Their eyes were kept from recognizing him," is what Luke says. What blinded them? What kept them from comprehending? What keeps us from comprehending? One person has noted, "Perhaps we can excuse these two disciples for their poor seeing and listening and understanding. The death of Jesus had dealt them a terrible blow. Grief gripped them in its powerful claws and numbed their senses. The crushing experiences of recent days mandated freewheeling discussion just to let out the grief. I suppose we could excuse ourselves in the same way," he said. "Life deals us some hard blows, too, enough to dull our memories of the Master's teachings and to clog our awareness of his presence. Sickness, sorrow, joblessness, anxiety about family and friends, all of these overwhelm us and diminish our attentiveness. They fill us with ourselves and what we are doing, so we have trouble recognizing the Master when he walks alongside of us." Perhaps this is exactly what happens as Jesus sits down to eat with these two disciples. All along on the road to Emmaus, they had been filled with themselves. Now, at dinner, Jesus fills them with him. Now he does something with them he has done with them before. He gives them this sacrament, and it becomes a sacred moment. Then, Luke says, then their eyes were opened. As Frederick Buechner once said, a sacrament is when something holy happens. It is transparent time, time when you can see through to something deep inside time. This is certainly what happened for those two disciples. The promise we have inherited is that this same gift is here for us today, for us to receive as well. Henry Nouwen once wrote, "When we invite friends for a meal, we do much more than offer them food for their bodies. We offer friendship, fellowship, good conversation, intimacy, and closeness. When we say, help yourself, take some more, don't be shy, have another glass, we offer our guests not only our food and our drink, but also ourselves. A spiritual bond grows, and we become food and drink for one another. In the most complete and perfect way, Nouwen went on, this happens when Jesus gives himself to us in the Eucharist as food and drink. By offering us his body and blood, Jesus offers us the most intimate communion possible. It is a divine communion. When the two disciples recognized Jesus as he broke the bread for them in their house in Emmaus, he, quote, vanished from their sight. The recognition and the disappearance of Jesus are one and the same event. Why? Nouwen asks. Because the disciples recognize that their Lord Jesus, the Christ, now lives in them, that they have become Christ bearers. Therefore, Jesus no longer sits across the table from them as the stranger, the guest, the friend with whom they can speak and from whom they can receive good counsel. He has become one with them. He has given them his own spirit of love. Their companion on the journey has become the companion of their souls. They are alive. Yet it is no longer them, but Christ living in them. This is the gift being held out to us in the bread and the wine we receive today. Jesus is here to be the companion of our souls. He is our food and drink. His spirit is given so that it might intermingle with our own. It is given so that this might be a sacred moment for us. Jesus has taken our lives into his. He comes to us this day so that we might take his into ours. Amen.
Uplifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, we join the people of God in all times and all places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need. For those whose hearts are fervent with love for your gospel, that they are empowered to tell the story of your love in their lives and to show hospitality in response to this love, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For the diverse natural world, for jungles, prairies, forests, valleys, mountains, and for all the wild and endangered animals who call these spaces home, that they are nurtured and protected. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For broken systems we have inherited and that we continue to perpetuate, forgive us. Restrain the nations from fighting over limited resources. Redeem us from the cycles of scarcity and violence. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Open the hearts we close as you care for our needs even before we ask. In the midst of a global crisis, we look to you for strength, hope, and help in fighting the coronavirus pandemic. We pray for those stricken with this disease and those who are treating them, for those mourning the loss of life and those facing death, for those urgently working to find effective treatments for cure. We lift up to you those in our faith community needing your care. The family of James Crockett, the mother of Laurel Goforth, friend of Sarah Pierce, Dorothy, Mary, Phil, Levi, Lynn, David, Dee, Trina, and those we name aloud or silently in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
For the faith-forming ministries of this church, for those preparing for baptism, First Communion, confirmation, and membership, for those who participate in Sunday school and adult education, guide and inspire learners of every age and ability. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Create in our hearts a yearning to rest in your promise of eternal and resurrected life. Give us thankful hearts for those who have died, even as we look forward to the hope of new life. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
With bold confidence in your love, Almighty God, we place all for whom we pray into your eternal care, through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are raised with him to new life. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning you created us in your image and planted us in a well-watered garden. In the desert, you promised pools of waters for the parched, and you gave us water from the rock. When we did not know the way, you sent the Good Shepherd to lead us to still waters. At the cross, you watered us from Jesus' wounded side, and on this day, you shower us again with the water of life. We praise you for your salvation through water, for the water in our baptismal font, and for all water everywhere. Bathe us in your forgiveness, grace, and love. Satisfy the thirsty, and give us the life only you can give. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share together God's peace and share with those who are worshiping with you this day. God's peace. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. Holy God, mighty Lord, gracious Father, endless is your mercy and eternal your reign. You have filled all creation with light and life. Heaven and earth are full of your glory. We praise you for the grace shown to your people in every age, the promise to Israel, the rescue from Egypt, the gift of the promised land, the words of the prophets, and at this end of all the ages, the gift of your Son, who proclaimed the good news in word and deed, and was obedient to your will, even to giving his life. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Therefore, O God, with this bread and cup, we remember the life our Lord offered for us. And believing the witness of his resurrection, we await his coming in power to share with us the great and promised feast. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Send now, we pray, your Holy Spirit, that we who share in Christ's body and blood may live to the praise of your glory and receive our inheritance with all your saints in light. Amen. Come, Holy Spirit. Join our prayers with those of your servants of every time and every place, and unite them with the ceaseless petitions of our great high priest until he comes as victorious Lord of all. Through him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Come to the banquet. Behold the risen Christ. All are welcome. Let us now share the sacrament together. This is the body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
And this is the blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. This is the body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
This is the blood of Christ shed for you.
Amen. As we have received this sacrament, as the family of God, let us now receive God's blessing. May the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen us and keep us in his grace. Amen. Let us pray together. Living God, you have created us in our brokenness and nourished us with the body of Christ broken for us. Risen to new life with you, send us now to bear your healing love into the wounded world, in the name of our risen Savior and Lord. Amen. May the one who brought forth Jesus from the dead raise you to new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
You will hear my voice.
As a people of faith, living in the light of the resurrection, Jesus comes to us. Jesus lives in us. God calls us as Christians to be Jesus to our community and to be Jesus to the world. We are the face of Jesus. We are the hands of Jesus. We are called to be the body of Christ. With that knowledge, with that responsibility, and in faith, let us go in peace and service to our Lord.